It's Matthews, I'm one of the technical specialists at Fargro, and today I'm going to be speaking you through macrobiological control options for thrips and how we can assess the entire life cycle of the thrips species to get a comprehensive control using macrobiologicals through the season. So as an introduction to this presentation, firstly we're going to be looking at a quick overview of the thrips, looking at the key identification factors including feeding damage. Then we're going to be moving on to the thrips life cycle and then to specific thrip species. These will be key ones that we generally see in the environment and that cause the most extensive damage, and also how to identify each species. And then we'll be finally going on to macrobiological control options, looking at how we can use specific macrobiological species to target each specific thrip species. Very quick overview of thrips. They have basically a very wide host range. There's a lot of different species and they're able to transmit viruses and can potentially have very high economic damage. We see a lot of evacuation off crops, especially during the harvest time for arable crops, and that's when we start to see the highest damage and migration into horticultural crops, especially crops under glass, where we get a mass emergence and invasion through the vents. As a feeding damage, they create like a silvering feeding damage across the leaf surface, and we can see this on the basal leaf on the right hand side, where we get this silvering damage with these black frass deposits within that feeding damage. So very key identifying features. The damage can occur on leaf tissue, flowers, fruit and buds, so they can be quite extensive, and hotter conditions the life cycle can be very rapid. So looking at the western flower thrips life cycle in particular, and this is the life cycle that we generally do see throughout the thrip species. However, we will discuss some of the other newer thrip species that we are seeing, and how they slightly differ, especially at the pupal stage. But as you can see here, they the thrips basically, the egg is laid into the leaf surface itself. It then emerges the first into the larval stage, then emerges out. It has two larval stages, and then it they'll basically drop off the leaf or foliage to pupate in the soil, and then we'll get this re-emergence onto the plants and into the canopy with the adults, which are winged and very mobile in the environment. The larval stages are unable to fly, so generally when we're looking at sticky trap control and things like that and migration, it's generally the adult stage that we are seeing that's very mobile through the environment. A very key thrip species that we deal with, one of the most prevalent and widely dispersed and probably has the highest economic damage, is western flower thrips, or Francanella occidentalis. Has a very wide host range and is able to transmit viruses. It is a vector for virus, and as I said, able to cause a severe economic damage to fruiting and flowering parts of the plant. Due to its presence and extensive spraying that's occurred, this species in particular is resistant to some of the key active groups, insecticide groups that we do use, including spinosad and abamectin, which places greater emphasis on using macrobiological control options for this particular species. Second species that's notable is onion thrips, or thrips tabaci. It's very similar in appearance to western flower thrips, as we can see on the right hand side. Tends to inhibit lower leaves, and we do see this given its name. It does have preference for the allium family, including things like chives, garlic, onions. But as I said, it is seen very extensively across a range of different host plants. Japanese or eastern flower thrips, thripsitosis, is another one as a species that's very much on the increase, and we are seeing a lot more prevalently. Has a very polyphagous diet, similar to that of Western flower thrips or WFT. Has a dark brown to black body and sort of light wings as it attaches to the main body. Able to transmit viruses, including tomato spotted wilt virus. So it can be very economically damaging if it does get established. Similar in the life cycle to Western flower thrips, eggs laid in the leaf and first and second into the larval stage feed in patches and on the underside of leaves, causing again that sort of silvering damage with the black fecal matter, the fecal pellets within the damage. This species does not feed on pollen but will damage flowers. And just carrying on, this is what the thrips looks like on the right hand side. As we were saying, sort of a dark body with the lighter sort of wings as it attaches to the main body. It is tricky in the fact of its control, and we will go into more detail about this due to the large first and second insta-larval stage. It is quite tricky to control with specific mites that we have, so we do rely on switching up these mites from one of the main species that we do use, which is Amblyosis cucumeris, for Amblyosis montarensis, which I'll go into more detail later on in this talk. Glasshouse thrips are really key for this year, especially as we've seen really hot conditions, and it's one that I've sort of put a bit more information in, just if people are starting to identify this a lot more in the environment. As the name goes, it is a glasshouse thrips. However, as I said, with the hot temperatures we've had this year, we have seen the species developing and moving outside of the glasshouse environment and causing quite extensive damage. From the right-hand side, the life cycle of this species can differ slightly because whereas at the pupal stage with species such as Western flower thrips and onion thrips, we see them falling off the leaf surface into the soil structure and then pupating within that soil structure. Glasshouse thrips can pupate on the leaf surface, so it's just a slight change in behaviour. But as you can see on the right-hand side, we do get these dense clusters of colonies on the leaf surface, which is quite distinct for this type of species. And just going on from that, as I was saying, this species has moved out of the glasshouse setting, especially this year with the warmer conditions. So hopefully, if we get a real cold snap this winter, we will see a big drop off into next season. However, if it remains quite mild this winter, we're expecting quite high pressure from this species, and as we can see, the extensive damage on the plant species of species like viburnum, it is quite extensive. And we get this defoliation that starts sort of lower in the crop canopy and then moves through it as a very distinct damage. Quite difficult to spot early on, but regular crop walking is quite important just to try and catch this species early. So the glasshouse thrips has originated in South America and usually, as I said, isolated to glasshouses. However, this year it has been starting to move outdoors and affect outdoor plants. The large insta-larval stages, as we mentioned, for thripsitosis or Japanese thrips, makes it tricky for the Amblyosis cucumeris to actually gain control. So switching to Amblyosis montarensis is required to actually control both stages of the life of the first and second insta-larval stage. As the Amblyosis montarensis is a slightly bigger predator and more voracious. The only issue is this species is licensed only under for application only under glasshouse. So if you do have an outdoor outbreak, it is a bit trickier to control, and we have to look at different control options available, which might incorporate some spraying and also looking at aureus and different macrobiological controls as an option. So now we're going to look through macrobiological control options. So I've just put a list in here of all the species that we're going to look through. So predatory mite species and predatory insects as well. So I'll go through each of these species and just highlight some of the key key factors and why we sort of select these species as a control for thrips. So the first one to look at that we're looking at is Amblyces cucumeris. It's one of the most widely applied predatory mites that we put down for control of thrips. Used at a rate of about 50 to 250 mites per meter squared, but this can vary depending on the situation. And this species is active from 12 degrees with an optimum temperature between 20 to 27.2. It's a mite species, so we've got a lot of different formulations that we can apply this in depending on the situation. So we can range from applying as a loose product, so which is distributed across the leaf surface, and we also do control release sachets, which will release for up to 4 to 6 weeks. And as I've attached here a picture on the right hand side of the sachet options we provide. We've got many different sachet designs just to suit different situations. And we find these really effective as you get a breeding colony within each sachet. So you get a continuous release, very good for early preventative control of thrips to try and reduce any build-up and spike in thrips populations. So we're getting them early in the colony establishment. This species is very, very useful against those key thrip species that we were talking about, including western flower thrips and also onion thrips and many other species we do use it for. Moving on, Amblyces montarensis, as I've touched on earlier in the talk, early in this presentation. We apply this at a rate of about 50 to 250 mites per meter squared, but again, this depends on the situation. This species is active from similar temperature ranges as the Amblyces cucumeris, so active from about 12 degrees optimum to 20 to 27 degrees, and is very extensive again in its formulations of what we apply it in, so going from loose product formulations to also the control release sachets as well for 4 to 6 weeks continuous release. As we mentioned earlier, it is restricted under license, this species, so we can't apply it to outdoor crops, unfortunately, but it is very, very useful, and we are finding really good results with control of species such as thripsitosis and heliothrips, just because it is able to target that first and second insta larval stage, whereas with the other mite species like cucumeris, it will predominantly only target one stage. And it doesn't, because the heliothrips and thripsitosis generally have quite large insta-larval stages, the other species don't necessarily like going for these particular thrip species because they do find them a bit too large to attack. So we do find Amblyces montarensis is a really effective predator for some of these newer species that we're encountering. Amblyces swirsky is another species, mite species, that we do use very extensively. Applied at a rate of about 100 to 250 mites per meter squared, again, depending on situation. Requires a minimum temperature of over 18 degrees and optimum of 25 degrees. So this is one of the warmer temperature mites, and we put these in sort of into the higher summer months, really, where we are battling the warmer temperatures, and those thrips species, the thrips life cycle is replicating a lot more rapidly than earlier or later in the season, so we use this species as a really effective knockdown in those warmer conditions. Again, a very extensive formulations that we offer this species in, from loose bran vermiculite, which can be sprinkled directly over the plants, and we also do control release sachets containing the breeding colonies for continuously releasing between 4 to 6 weeks. Again, as with montarensis, this is restricted under license, so it could only be applied under glasshouse conditions, and we use this species for predating a wide range of different thrip species at very warm temperatures. Moving on to one of the another mite species that we can use. So all the other mite species that we've been discussing are all predators on the leaf surface, whereas Hypoaspis is a saw-dwelling predatory mite that we use for targeting thrips pupae that are present within, that fall off the leaf surface and are present within the soil structure, so we can target them at that specific stage in the life cycle. Applied at a rate of use of about 100 mites per meter squared, and required for requires a minimum temperature of 12 degrees within the soil for activity. We offer this as a formulation of loose material with peat and vermiculite carrier. Very easy to apply, and this predator is predominantly applied for sciarid control, but it's quite a useful generalist for all of those pest species, for pest species that do exist within the soil structure. As we were saying with thrips pupae, it can be very effective. So just another way we can target another stage of the life cycle to try and bring down the thrips populations by attacking them at different parts of the life cycle. So aureus, moving on to predatory insects. So rate of use is 0.5 to 1 individuals per meter squared, depending on the situation. Optimum temperature range is between 18 to 25 degrees and a minimum of 15 degrees for activity. This is applied as sort of a loose formulation material for sprinkling directly over plants. Very effective predator for thrips control. This species is because it's got, as you can see on the picture on the right-hand side, it's got a stabbing proboscis, which means that it can target all stages of the thrips life cycle, apart from the eggs, which are planted into the leaf surface. So we use these very effectively at targeting a wide range of different thrip species, and we do also see this species occurring very naturally in the environment, and a lot within wildflower mixes. So within establishing wildflower mixes around the around glass houses, for example, and around around the sites, we can effectively have a migration of these species into the glass house as natural biological controllers, as this is also known as aureus is also known as a flower bug, or a true flower bug. So it relies on having flowers, and establishes really well on flowering crops as it can feed on pollens. So yeah, a very effective predator for targeting the majority of the thrips life stage. Look, moving on to chrysoperla, which is a lacewing larvae. As we can see on the right-hand side, this is the stage that we apply them in, but they're generally seen and identified by the green lacewing that overwinter inside. Rate of use is between 5 to 10 larvae per meter squared, and this species is active from 12 degrees, but an optimum of 20 to 28 degrees is preferable. Formulations, we do offer this as a loose formulation material buckwheat for sprinkling directly over plants. A very useful generalist predator is chrysoperla. It attacks a wide range of soft-bodied pests, mainly applied for aphid and those sort of that sort of group of pests. But as they're saying, it is a generalist predator, so it is able to attack a wide range of different pest species, as we say, including thrips, which we do find as a reduction, and does bring down the populations quite well. Finally, moving on to Atheta, which again is a soil-dwelling predatory beetle. It's applied as it's different methods of application, so we can apply them within a peat and vermiculite carrier, but we also do them as breeding buckets as well. So they can you can actually actively have a breeding colony and have those released continuously over the course of 8 weeks. The species is generally applied at a rate of 5 to 10 individuals per meter squared, and requires a minimum temperature of about 12 degrees for activity. And yeah, as I was saying, with the soil-dwelling nature of this beetle, it's very similar to hypoaspis in the fact that it's attacking the pupal stage of the thrips that have fallen off that leaf surface, and are actively pupating within the soil structure. So very useful for targeting that extra part of the thrips life stage. Finally, I've just added in his sticky traps, specifically blue sticky traps, which we do see are really effective for thrips control, as the majority of the biological control relies on targeting of the larval stage, apart from species such as aureus, which will target the adults as well. Because the thrips are so mobile in the environment, we do find the adults quite tricky to control sometimes with biologicals, especially if we do get a mass migration of thrips into an environment all at once. So, for example, during the arable harvest time, when we do get a mass migration of thrips, and it can sometimes overwhelm a biological program, we rely on putting out blue sticky traps for catching the migrating adults, with the blue color found to attract be the best color for attracting thrips specifically. We also offer these traps with pheromones in as well, so they've got specific Western flower thrips pheromones in for added attraction, and also have been found to, with the patterning designs on the traps as well, does improve trap catch. There's also products like Thrip Knock as well, which will also be an added attractant, which we can stick onto the sticky traps to attract Western flower thrips and also onion thrips. So another way we can really effectively target another stage of the thrips life stage, and these traps really do complement themselves alongside the biological control in pulling out and targeting as much of that thrips life cycle as possible. So just finally, looking again at that Western flower thrips life cycle, and I've added in the controls around here. So with the mites, as we were discussing, and aureus, we're able to target the first and second instalarval stage. And then moving on to the pupal stages, we've got hypoaspis and atheta active in the soil structure, actively predating on those pupal stages before they emerge as adults. And then finally, we've got the aureus attacking the majority of the stages of the life cycle, including the adults, and also the sticky traps, whether that be blue or yellow, in the environment just to increase catch from the flying adults. Just to say thank you for your attention, and I hope you enjoyed the presentation. If you have any questions at all, please don't hesitate to get in contact. The email below is biosales@fargro.co.uk, or please feel free to call 01903 256 857, and thank you very much.